So far, we've been looking at the flows within several adjacent households. Now let us have a look at an urban neighborhood or district. Here we usually see not only households, but also schools, offices, shops and restaurants, as well as public spaces, like streets, squares and parks. All of these are related to the same resource and waste flows. Schools, offices, shops and restaurants all need energy for space heating, maybe cooling, and electricity for light and different appliances. They all need water for sanitary rooms and maybe kitchens. And they all use different products and produce different types of waste. However, these various amenities have different consumption patterns. While schools and offices are active mainly during daytime, restaurants consume most energy and water during the evening. Shops may have a peak in consumption on Saturdays, when schools and offices are closed. Also, the quantities of consumed resources and produced waste may differ among the different amenities. Restaurants usually need a lot more water than offices, which in turn have the highest demand for cooling due to the common heat load of computers. Similar to what we saw at the scale of a household, each of these other urban programs offer opportunities for improving individual flows. In an office, for instance, it might be possible to replace air conditioning with natural ventilation, and the restaurant could focus on cooking with leftovers, for example. But actually, flows at neighborhood scale can be much more radically improved by implementing collective approaches that go beyond flow improvement at the scale of the individual building. Here are some examples. A local electricity net may connect the PV cells on different roofs of a number of buildings, allowing to share locally produced energy with each other. Electric cars could be connected to such a smart grid to serve as a collective energy buffer. Waste heat from offices or supermarkets could be used for heating apartments. For rainwater, a whole range of improvements can be found. Permeable pavements can allow rainwater to infiltrate. So-called bioswales can be used to collect, contain, and slowly release rainwater during heavy rainfalls. And of course, water can be directed to parks to allow infiltration there. At the level of the neighborhood, it may even be possible to locally manage wastewater, for example by treating it in constructed wetlands and thereafter letting it infiltrate or run off to rivers and lakes. And also, for products and waste, the neighborhood scale offers interesting opportunities for collective approaches. Local thrift and repair shops can support the reuse of different consumer goods and benefit local entrepreneurship. Conscious positioning of containers for waste collection could stimulate awareness of waste separation.
If we zoom out further and look at a whole city, again, more opportunities for improving flows arise. On this large scale, transportation plays a very important role. If a city offers good public transport, bicycle routes, and general walkability, then this may lead to a reduction in the use of private cars and the related greenhouse gas emissions. Different clusters of programs may offer more opportunities for exchanging waste heat through larger heat networks. For the water system, an important system change can be introduced at the level of the city. If rainwater is separated from other wastewater in a separated sewage network, then this part of the sewage can be discharged untreated, reducing the energy needed and the environmental impact of the respective water purification plants. Eventually, also the waste collection and treatment system can be reorganized on the scale of the city. Separating paper, glass, green waste, and packaging material can reduce the amount of waste.
As we see, each level, household, neighborhood, and city, offers different types of individual, collective, and institutional possibilities for more circularity. It depends on the spatial, political, social, and economic context, which solutions work, and how they should be organized.
There is not one blueprint for a circular city, but there are many different ways to work towards it. Some solutions seem small, but have a large impact. Others change our current system completely.